God. Yeah. Hey. 9-on-1, Shelby Drive, look alive, look alive. Came up on this side, now they on the other side. Oh well, fuck them dog, we gon' see how hard they ride. I get rested.
Welcome back to Tigers in 20. Is the 20th episode. We can never stick to actually doing this in 20 minutes, so I don't really know if there's any kind of significance to 20 and 20. Who knows? But no. I'm Brooks Hansen, founder of GoTigers247, and joining me as always is Christian Fowler, but this week he sounds like Alvin from Alvin and the Chipmunks. What's up, Christian?
Is it that bad? I didn't think it was that bad.
No, it's not
Alvin.
That bad. It's not that bad. Christian's a little under the weather. But we are going to bring you as much Memphis as we can in 20-ish minutes. So, Christian, what's going on, man?
Oh, nothing much. But the 20-ish minutes, if you paid attention to last week, we had our shortest episode ever. So I'm proud of us. We were like 21 minutes last week. So we're getting there.
Yes, sir. All right, so we're going to go through SMU from this past weekend and Memphis's monster win over the Mustangs. We're going to talk about Temple and UCF, one on the road, one back at home. We're going to talk about East next two games against Whitehaven and then against Mountain Brook High School from Birmingham, Alabama, Trendon Watford's club. So big recruiting implications for Memphis with East next two big games. And then we're going to do some Q&A. We haven't done that in a while. We did one last week and I kind of ran it. So Christian, first, getting into Memphis versus SMU, the Memphis State game. Wow. And Memphis actually showed up to play in a big way.
Oh, you summed it up perfectly with wow. I mean, that was probably the best word to describe the game right there, because we've been talking about this three-game stretch starting with SMU for a while now and how important it was. We really didn't know what to expect. We were kind of curious about how they would play against SMU and what they were going to look like, especially coming off that sloppy performance against Tulane in New Orleans. It was really up in the air. SMU hasn't been great this season, but they've been about the same level as Memphis, so it's one of those games that could have went either way. But they came out, the Memphis State game, 16,000-plus fans, the retro uniforms, which were, man, they were awesome.
Unbelievable.
I would not be mad if they wore those for the rest of the season. Those uniforms are great. But multiple players, and even Coach Hardaway joked about it during the post-game press conference, that the jerseys, you know, gave them a little extra spark and maybe had a little magic in them. And they definitely came out to play. I don't think there was a weak spot in the game, offensively or defensively, during the game. When you can hold a team, you know, 6.5-7 minutes without scoring, especially a team like Memphis that's been allowing 70-plus points a game this season. They've had statistically had the worst defense in the AAC this season, and they come out and they blank SMU through the first 6.5-7 minutes. I mean, you can't say enough about that.
Christian, here's the thing, too. SMU was lucky to only be down by the deficit that they were. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Memphis held them scoreless and didn't exactly, like, they weren't world beaters on offense for the first 7 minutes of that game. It really happened later in the game when that offensive explosion happened. SMU could have been down by, like, 30.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, just watching the way that the rest of the game played out. So that game could have gotten a lot more out of hand.
No, absolutely. When SMU finally scored, Memphis only had 13. And like you said, their scoring stretch was in the middle of the second half. In the middle of the second half, they couldn't miss. I mean, they went up by as much as 35. That's why the 22-point win really didn't do the game justice, because they pulled off the gas there at the end and, you know, kind of put in some of the reserves. But in the middle of the second half of that game, it was just total domination. Like I said, 35-plus points. SMU was completely out of it. And one of the biggest matchups going into the game, and this is a common theme that me and you have talked about throughout the season, is Memphis doesn't have a great defense, but they are so good on star players. It just shows you the game planning that Coach Hardaway and his staff are doing. Because Jamal McMurray came in as one of the top scorers in the conference. And they shut him down. He couldn't do anything. He probably ended with 8 or 10 points, but it was just because they pulled off the gas so much at the end of the second half. But they blanked him. He couldn't shoot. They rattled him. They were in his head. He couldn't do anything. So it just, once again, it's a testimony to the game planning and what they're doing on these star players. And it hasn't necessarily translated to shutting teams down overall, but they're definitely on the right track with the way they play against star players and these high-powered offensive players.
Well, Christian, one of the things that we've been talking about over the last few weeks is the areas that Memphis needs to improve, and that's rebounding, turnovers, and the play of the freshmen. Last week, rebounding, they got an F. The play of the freshman, they got a
D.
B.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then turnovers, they got what?
A B.
So, going into this game, this was the first of a three-game stretch where we wanted to look and see, could they legitimately improve those grades? And across the board, I don't think there's any question, every single one of those grades improved. Every one of them. You look at rebounding. Memphis out-rebounded SMU, that came in as one of the best rebounding teams in the conference. Offensive rebounding-wise, SMU is right up there, even though they are a little bit undersized. And Memphis out-rebounded them. It was barely, but they still did. Turnovers, I think they ended the game with, 12 turnovers? And really, a lot of those were just kind of like careless, almost showing off, because there was a lot of showmanship once things got out of control. And then the freshmen were really, really good. Antoine Jones went back to being good Antoine Jones. Tyler Harris found his stroke again. So across the board, I was extremely pleased with how the grades were going to turn out tonight. So let's do it. Let's grade them. I'll let you take first. What do you think?
Oh, if we're going off rebounding first,
yeah.
I'm going to give it an A-, and say the biggest point there would be Rainier Thornton. He hasn't gotten much credit this season. He's been up and down. So, I mean, it's really not – you can't really give too much credit for he's been up and down a lot of the season. But you have seen the hustle from him, man. He mm-hmm. constantly hustles. He never stops. He never gives up on a play, which is a common theme throughout this group. But he played probably his best game in a Memphis uniform against SMU with 11 points, career-high 14 rebounds. He was a menace all night on the board. So rebounding A-, in large part due to Rainier Thornton's performance.
Yeah, I mean, I think Rainier Thornton, you remove him and his 14 rebounds from that stat line, and Memphis goes from an A- to maybe a C+, a decent game of rebounding, not horrible, not great. But Rainier Thornton and his energy on the boards made all the difference in the world for Memphis. If they can get even remotely decent consistent production from him in terms of a rebounding 4-3 player, a forward that can step out and play the wing some, that will help them a lot in that area. So turnovers, I think I already said it. I'm going to give them an A. If we're going to give them a B for last week in that performance, I'm going to go with an A. I really wanted to see them under double digits, under 10 turnovers. But like I said, a lot of that was just sloppy play, getting a little loose and having some fun towards the end of the game. So, I mean, you disagree with me at all?
No, I'm with you there. I think they probably had 7 or 8 turnovers going into the last 3 or 4 minutes, and they put the reserves in. And that's typically what happens when you put the reserves in. So I don't have any arguments there. Lastly, play of the freshman. I'm going to go a little bit lower, but I'm going to go B+ on it. Not that they didn't play great. And to me, the biggest stat, I believe Lomax Harris and Antoine Jones combined for 19, 8, and 8. But the biggest stat line there would be that those three players only combined for 3 turnovers. In the game before, I think they combined for 11. I think in the two-lane game, they combined for 11 turnovers. And that was just between Harris and Jones because Lomax didn't even play. So getting that turnover number down to 3 was massive. And then you take a look at Tyler Harris, who's been in a bit of a slump that we've talked about over the past few weeks. He hasn't looked incredible over the past few games. Looks like he might have been losing a little bit of confidence. In the beginning of the second half, he started knocking down some shots, got back into a rhythm, looked like he was having fun again on the court, which is a great sign. He ended with 14 points, played a great game. Alex Lomax didn't play a ton and definitely didn't have a lot of points on the board, but he did what Alex Lomax does. He played good defense, was able to move the ball a little bit and run the floor, so he had a nice performance as well. And then Antoine Jones did his thing. He didn't have a huge statistical performance at all, but it was the way he ran the floor, man. He ran the floor so good. The spacing was great when he had the ball in his hands. You know how I feel about him in the passing lanes and how he sees the passing lanes, and he did that once again.
Yeah, he had a couple passes on Saturday that were just kind of like, how did you see that? How did you get that ball in there?
Absolutely.
Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind that Antoine Jones, even though he finished with 2 points, five assists, five rebounds, and those five rebounds, that's from a guard. You know, that's good. That five contributes to Memphis's B plus on the rebounding. So, or what did we say? A minus.
A minus. Yeah.
A minus. So, you know, even though he didn't have like a 12 point, five assist, five rebound, he had a massive impact on that game. He allowed Tyler Harris to kind of play off the ball some, which freed him up for those 14 points, finally finding his stroke a little bit. And then Alex Lomax, yeah, like you said, he did what Alex Lomax does. He gave them, I think it was like 15, 17 minutes to be able to give some backup. And, you know, it allowed Kareem Bruton, those three guys playing the point, allowed Kareem Bruton to have the big game that he had. So, you know, a lot of Kareem Bruton's points came off of him just like hanging out on the wing and waiting for the ball, you know, waiting for them to break down the defense and kick it to him. So yeah, I mean, I'm right there with you. I think I'd go a B. So we're going to disagree a little bit. I think we'll, so you said B minus?
I said B plus.
Okay. I'll say B plus. I'll go with you. I was going to one up you.
I've swung you. So
you swung me. You pulled up the GPA. You argued with the professor.
Brooks, now that we've discussed that big win, possibly Memphis's biggest win of the season, they go into that two-game stretch we've been talking about now with Temple and UCF, two of the best teams in the conference. So what do you think they can take away from that win against SMU and really put forward into these next couple games?
Well, one, they check off a win, and they say, you know, if you look at it and say, can we compete with the top in the conference? You know, SMU has fallen a little bit. They had two straight losses, had a couple guys injured, but they're still top of the conference. Can they compete? Yes, check. So you get a win, you start to believe that you can compete with the best in the conference. Not only compete, but demolish the best in the conference. So what that does for me is you look at the way that Memphis's staff obviously had this team prepared for SMU, had them hyped up for Memphis State Day, had them prepared for their matchup, for their individual matchups, and then had them prepared to address the problems, rebounding, turnovers, play of the freshmen, energy from guys like Rainier Thornton, from Kareem Bruton. You know, this week Penny Hardaway talked about Kareem Bruton buying in and earning his minutes with his energy and his ability to contribute and actually, you know, having to earn his playing time. And that all showed. And that, just like we talked about with the academics, it's all about the precedent from the coaching staff. This coaching staff has set the tone for this team now, and I believe they're fully buying in. And you see it across the board. You guys slowly coming along, playing with energy. They're starting to fit into the system more. That you see their offense developing to where they actually have good spacing on their horns plays, and when they try to create spacing for dribble drives or even their you know, ISO stuff for Jeremiah Martin, whenever they run him out, ISO and then kick. All of that stuff looks a million times better than it did even 4 weeks ago. And that's all coaching. That's all teaching. That's all constantly drilling it into these guys' heads. So, you know, for me, I guess what I take from SMU is this staff is going to have these guys prepared. It's just a matter of whether or not they bring that consistent level of energy, that they have that same level of emotion playing against Temple on the road that they did at home with a crowd of 16,000 plus and wearing throwback jerseys that represent their coach's era. So I guess that's, for me, is the big thing. What I mean, I know for you, you personally, you're a big energy guy. What did you take away from the SMU game about that?
Yeah, Brooks, I think the energy portion is really the biggest takeaway from the game, and the difference that it made, you could really see. It was very visible. The coaching was obviously great. I'm not disagreeing there at all. The adjustments from the staff have been great. They've clearly made strides with this group and where they're going. but I actually got a chance to ask Coach Hardaway about it in the post-game press conference, and this is what he had to say.
I think that we're just starting to believe more. We're starting to believe in what we're doing. The kids are starting to buy in more to the game plan, and everybody's so into what we're doing now, you know, as a team, as a family, the brotherhood with the players. So everybody's into it now. Where at first guys might have been caught up that they weren't into the game or they didn't get enough shots or not enough minutes, now everybody's won, so starting to play better.
When you look at what Penny said there, it really sums it up perfectly. I mean, he absolutely hit the nail on the head with it. This team is starting to believe. They're starting to come together as one unit, and I think you saw the product of that against SMU. And to break it down and to really look at it, this team's been kind of timid this year. They've been trying to find their footing. They've been trying to learn who they are with a new coach and a lot of new guys in the rotation. And it was, I mean, SMU was their coming out party, plain and simple. To me, the biggest moment to show that and that describes that is late in the second half, Keeman Davenport gets fouled by William Douglas, I believe, and they start jawing. The whole team's on his back. That hasn't happened this season. There hasn't been a moment where a Memphis player has kind of gotten into it with somebody and been like, you know, we belong here, we should be here, we have a right to be in your face right now. And then two possessions later, Keeman Davenport throws down that monstrous dunk, and it just kind of was, it was just a statement to me. That whole sequence was a statement.
Yeah, you could tell those guys were actually having fun for once. Like, it really felt like the first game where, I mean, there have been moments. I'm not saying that those guys have looked miserable playing.
No.
They definitely have looked like they've had a ton of fun, but they looked like they were having a legitimate blast. So those moments that you talked about, but another one that really stuck out to me was Mikey Gardner, our photographer. He caught a shot of Tyler Harris shooting a three, and the ball is in midair, and Jeremiah Martin has his back turned facing the other goal, and he's simply walking away with three in the air. And I love that shot because it showed a level of confidence from Jeremiah Martin and the freshman. It showed that they just felt that energy that the ball was going in. You know, sometimes if you play ball, you get in that rhythm and you know what's going in. And I think that this team against SMU, they had those moments. And so moving into the next stretch of games, I think we've got to be consistent. You've got to still continue to look at rebounding, at turnovers, and the play of the freshmen. You've got Temple on the road, you've got UCF, and then you've got two very winnable games. And then you turn around and then you play Cincinnati. Three of your next five are against three of the top five. If you take out Memphis, three of the top four teams in the conference right now. And by the way, did you catch that mind-blowing statement? Memphis is tied for third in the conference right now. Third.
Yeah. Like, I don't think anybody expected that at this point in the season for Memphis to be, you know, 4-1 in the conference and tied for third in the conference with Temple at this point.
Yeah, so, you know, now you look at it and you say, if Memphis can win even two of those three against the top teams, they go 4-1 over this next five, and they're looking at sitting at 8-2, and you're in the discussion for one of those top two or three seeds in the conference tournament, and that's massive, especially given that it's on their home floor at FedEx Forum. Every piece of momentum, everything that you can get on your side going in that conference tournament is big for Memphis. So this stretch is huge, because if you flip it and over this next stretch they go 1-4, they go from one of the top two or three teams in the conference to the lower half of the conference. And that makes winning that conference championship so hard. It's hard to win that many games against the top tier of competition in any conference in that short of amount of time. Really, really hard.
Yeah. When you take a step back and look at it, you look at the upcoming schedule, the encouraging thing for Memphis fans is that this stretch could not come at a better time in the season. It absolutely couldn't. If they would have started conference play with this stretch, there's no telling where they would be. But now when you look at Saturday's game. They're starting to get their swagger. They're starting to play together. Coming into what's going to be the defining stretch of the season, their toughest stretch of the season. And I don't think momentum is anything to shy away from and not to talk about, because momentum is massive. Mm-hmm. Even going on the road to Philadelphia to play a very good team in Temple that has a trio of really good stars that are dangerous scoring the basketball, you can't overstate the momentum from that SMU game and this team finally coming together, because that's going to be huge over the next couple games. Say they do end up dropping that game to Temple, I feel like they have more confidence now and more swag to build each other back up and to say, you know, we can play with these teams. Just because we dropped a game or lost a conference game doesn't mean we don't belong here and we're not good enough to compete in these games. So I really think this stretch comes at the perfect time for this team to be able to make a run and to make a defining stretch of the season.
Well, these games give this team an indication of whether or not, you know, deep down, can we win this tournament? Can we win this tournament and get a bid? Because if they, you know, they demolish SMU, if they go into Temple, even if they lose and they compete, they defend, and they fight tooth and nail and end up, you know, losing a close game, that gives them, you know, like you said, momentum. It gives them encouragement going into UCF and Cincinnati to say, we can compete with the top in the conference. That's all they need. That's all they need going into that AAC tournament championship week to possibly get a bid to the NCAA tournament. And I'm still saying it. Memphis could win out. They're not getting an at-large bid. I'm saying it. I'm going to stick with it. It's out of left field, but I'm sticking with it. I know a lot of people were talking about, can Memphis get on the bubble? It's not happening.
Okay, can we turn away from your negativity for a second and look at something that we really haven't talked about much this year and we probably should have been, is the momentum that this team has at home. The FedEx Forum has been huge for this team this year.
Yes, it has. Well,
they
are
10-1
at home. That's why Temple is so big. That's why Temple is so big. It is their first chance to get that resume road win and say, you know what, it doesn't have to be on our home floor. Yes, the AAC tournament's going to be on our home floor, but we want to show teams that we're going to come into their place and we're going to own it. You know, we're going to win this game. To me, they haven't shown that yet. So Temple is massive.
Absolutely. But to be 10-1 at home with your only loss coming against the number one team in the country right now,
yep.
I don't think there's many teams in the American that want to come play in the FedEx Forum right now.
For sure. And that bodes well for Memphis come tournament time. All right, moving from Memphis's next stretch of games to high school basketball and recruiting, Memphis East, the Mustangs have two massive games. One, they play Whitehaven High School, 2020 guard Matthew Morrell. Obviously a huge priority for Penny Hardaway and staff. And then over the weekend, they traveled to New Albany, Mississippi to face Trenton Watford and the Mountain Brook High School Spartans. So Christian, you'll be there for both of those games. What are you looking for from both the Memphis commits and the guys that they're chasing in Morrell and Trenton Watford?
Well, we know Tigers fans obviously love to keep their eyes on these high school kids that Memphis is recruiting. So we're going to go be their eyes for these next couple games. They're obviously both big matchups, like you said, with two Memphis commits and two guys that Memphis have highly prioritized, one in Trenton Watford for 2019, one in Matthew Morrell for 2020. And what I'll be looking for them is Memphis East and Whitehaven have already played earlier this season. I believe East squeaked out a 5 or 6 point win in that game. So it'll be another highly contested matchup. Last time we got to watch Matthew Morrell and the Lander Center, I think he blew us away. He's improved his game.
He put on a show.
Yeah. He's improved so much in his junior season on the offensive end of the floor. So we'll obviously be looking for him to have a nice game, in large part due to East not being great in the backcourt, which really sets up well for a matchup with Matthew Morrell. Yeah. And then when you look at Saturday night's matchup with Mountain Brook, I think that's really going to be a premier matchup. You've got star power all over the court in that game. James Wiseman, Malcolm Dandridge, Trenton Watford. I would think that Watford and Dandridge will see a lot of each other in that game, because I don't really think that East wants to put anybody else on Watford other than Dandridge. They don't have a ton of size outside of Wiseman and Dandridge, so we'll probably see a lot of them going against each other in one-on-ones. And that, I mean, that's a marquee matchup right there. That's a great, smooth offensive player in Trenton Watford, and a bulldog on defense in Malcolm Dandridge. So that, to me, that'll be the biggest matchup to look for Saturday night, and it's going to be a whole lot of fun.
Well, for me, Matthew Morrell does present a ton of problems for East High School. Who are they going to throw at him? That's one of my big things going in. I would fully expect for Matthew Morrell to have the opportunity to have a massive game. And it also, it puts James Wiseman up against Jordan Wilmore in the 7'4" center. So it's a great matchup in terms of seeing somebody actually James Wiseman's size for once. So that's going to be very, very interesting. Then you turn the corner and, you know, East High School, Malcolm Dandridge, James Watson, they're not a great matchup for Trenton Watford. In one of Mountain Brook's early season losses against Winona High School, Trenton Watford actually faced a front line of Winona that was very, very physical with them. They slowed the game down. They were, I mean, literally bullied him. You know, they refused to let him get the ball in the post, put a body on him everywhere he went. And he really struggled. So it's going to be interesting for me, especially knowing that the Memphis staff is probably going to be there in full force, trying to evaluate how Trenton Watford can go up against these guys. Because here's the thing. You look at a game like this, it gives you a full indication of how Trenton Watford would be in a practice scenario against a team of James Wiseman and Malcolm Dandridge in the post. If maybe, say, Lance Thomas is your center on practice team B and Trenton Watford is your four on the other practice team next year. So it gives this staff a chance to evaluate him in a real scenario that they could potentially see next season if they were to get a commitment from the four-star, five-star forward. So it's going to be really interesting to see how Trenton Watford tries to come out and set a, you know, kind of a pace of play for himself, knowing that he's got a very physical matchup against Malcolm Dandridge.
Brooks, we promised them that we would do some Q&A. We probably haven't done it in 10 episodes now, so I'm going to swing it over to you, let you do some rapid fire, and get everybody's questions answered.
All right, so I promise, one, I'm going to do this fast, and I'm trying to save Christian's voice here. So I'm just going to go through these as fast as I can, excuse the glow. How have Boyce, Hardaway, and Thomas looked in practice? Will any of them get major minutes next season? So there's two things I want to say about this. Boyce and Hardaway, we're always going to be four-year development type of players, regardless of where they went. When Boyce was going to UAB, he was going to redshirt. He was going to be a four-year player. It was going to be a development process for him. It's no different for Memphis and him and Hardaway, period. So I wouldn't say that they're going to get a ton of minutes next year, mainly because Memphis has a lot at their positions that could potentially play over them, and we also don't know who else they're getting in this recruiting class. Thomas, from all indications, I even talked to a former Tiger the other day that told me that Thomas can play. So I fully expect Thomas to be starting at the four spot next year, getting major minutes. That could, you know, obviously change depending on who they have commit in the late signing period, but would not shock me to see him playing 20 plus 25 minutes a game next year. How many players does Penny get in the late period? Was K2 Tigers? I would say two still. I still am going with two. It would shock me if they got any more than that, simply because it's going to be really hard to find the wiggle room with scholarships. You know, I wouldn't put anything past Penny because he's very creative with the stuff. He already showed that with getting Ryan Boyce late last spring. So we'll see. But I'm going to go with two, five total for 2019. Let's see. Well, I'm not going to answer that one. I'm sorry. So I apologize if I don't answer your question. Do y'all think that Jalen Green or Kyrie Walker will most likely be big guards that are pursued in the late period? So yeah, I mean, obviously we know that Jalen Green, Kyrie Walker, RJ Hampton are three of those 2020 guys that have the potential to reclassify to 2019. We'll see. I mean, Memphis is going to put pressure on them. They're going to try to get a commitment from them regardless of their class because they're that good. Memphis is right in the mix for all three of those guys. I fully expect Memphis to be in there on those. I think it'll be later in the spring before we know one way or the other what's going to happen with them.
Rapid fire, Brooks.
I think that's it. I'm sitting here looking. There's a question about sign-in period late for football. What current football commits do you think will actually sign on signing day? Who do you think is added to this class? Has the ship sailed on Zach Edwards? What do you think on that? I mean, that's a Christian Fowler special right there.
Everyone that I've talked to that's still committed seems pretty solid, and it's looking like what they've got now is what they're going to sign. I'm not going to say they're not going to add a couple more guys, but they're getting to that point where they're pretty full. 16 signees, 15 known signees, one that wanted to wait until signing day. So they have 16 signees right now, and I believe five guys that are still committed. So that's 21 with a couple more guys. They weren't expected to get a full class. So they're right around that edge where they're going to have to start picking and choosing what they want. Zach Edwards, I don't think the ship has sailed on him. He didn't come in with Rodriguez Clark this past weekend, but when I spoke to him, he said he was planning on coming in a couple more weekends, so he's still planning to visit. The ship has not sailed there. Getting him on campus is huge, but past that, you'll really have to see them pick and choose their guys over the next two or three weeks.
I like how you just snuck that in there, that sneaky secret signing day. That's pretty good. So that's all I got. That's the end of Q&A, rapid fire. I think I did pretty good. So, Christian, anything else?
No, like you said, I'm good. My voice is starting to go. Nobody else wants to hear me talk anymore.
All right. That said, thanks for joining us. Go to GoTigers247.com. Check out all the great content we're putting out. Going to have a ton of stuff this week from both the Whitehaven game, the Mountain Brook game, and obviously Memphis's two massive games against Temple and UCF. Otherwise, it's a wrap. See y'all next week. 9-on-1, Shelby Drive, look alive, look alive.